Yeah, so why are we talking about regions, right? Why are we talking about the Southern Superhub? Does that make sense in the global world? You know, by definition, any company that's launching today is a global company. Maybe regions aren't that important anymore. So when I started my first company 17 years ago, you know, first of all, my surroundings here in Munich weren't very supportive. You know, I felt like a crazy guy. You know, everybody looked at me like, you know, this is curious but probably insane. So all my customers were in the United States, and I got a lot of support from there. And so I never really thought about, you know, that it is actually important to have your local support in your local fabric. So that was my modus operandi for a long time. And frankly, if I didn't fly to the US from time to time, you know, I felt I was running out of oxygen. So something really amazing has happened in the last couple of years here in the south of Germany, in Bavaria, particularly in Munich. When I go out and meet people for dinner, all of a sudden I can talk about these crazy ideas. I no longer feel like a crazy one. I feel like maybe everybody has gone insane now. But you can talk about flying cars now over Schweinsachsen, and nobody will laugh at you. And so when Steffi and I discussed this a couple of months ago in her office, we felt it was important to actually highlight this change that our region has been undergoing. Because everybody's looking to Silicon Valley for innovation. And for a long time, that was true. You know, most of the truly groundbreaking innovation was coming from Silicon Valley, and it continues to come from Silicon Valley. But there are many other regions now in the world, Asia, but also in Europe, and particularly here, that will play a significant role in the future and are already beginning to play a significant role. So we have this panel of amazing entrepreneurs, and I think they are quite representative of the bandwidth and the variety of people who are actually starting companies here in the south of Germany. And so I would like to invite you on a journey with us to explore a little bit about what we are doing here. So I'd like to start off with Frederick. So Frederick, you started a company a couple of years ago called Magazzino. You're like a serial entrepreneur. You started your first company when you were 16. So tell us a little bit about Magazzino and what you are doing here in Munich. Yeah, actually, Frederick lives just across the street from my office in Schwabing. So we just had coffee the other day, and it's just amazing. Just discovering all these people in your local neighborhood that are doing amazing things. So tell us about it.
Yes. So what we do? I apologize. My voice left me a few days ago. What we do, we build robotics, and we do robotics for logistics. But when you think about robotics, most people think of orange arms, which actually come from this region as well, which do repetitive movement. That's not what we're doing. What we do, we build robots which have vision, so they have an eye and they have a brain. We teach the robots behavior, and we solve way more complex tasks than only moving repetitive objects from A to B. The first fields we are in is e-commerce. So whenever you order a shoe online, until now there's still people walking around from shelf to shelf picking those shoes, and we do that now with the robot. We've got most of the German fulfillment providers as our clients, as well as some of the larger manufacturing companies where we provide logistics in a robotized way. Maybe for an information, we've got the biggest advanced robotics team in software in Europe at the moment. Just you find all of those people in this area, and they're happy to move to Munich as well.
Yeah, and your technology is based a lot on open source software as well, right? You know, which is it's a big movement in Germany. If you look at all the Linux distributions, and a lot of them are actually sourced in Germany. And so, this is like a theme, this actually allows you to leapfrog a lot of the competition because yep. They're trying to reinvent the wheel. Yeah, thank you. So, Manfred, we have a typical DLD story, right? You know, so we met at DLB exactly a year ago, right? And so I have to admit, I'm a space buff, you know. My uncle Lutz started the first space company, private space company, in the 1970s. So when I went to my grandmother's place, I had all these pictures of rocket launches on the wall. And so obviously, as a little boy, that was very inspiring. So when we met at DLD, we were sitting at a dinner table next to each other. We actually found out that your mentor actually knew my uncle. And then we, of course, started to talk shop. So you're a space entrepreneur. Right, you actually were in the satellite business for quite a while, but now you you realize there are a lot of satellites flying around already. You know, is there a way we can leverage what's already there and make it more accessible to people who could actually do something with these interesting amounts of data? So tell us a little bit about Claudio.
Yeah, let me start maybe some introduction, because for most of the people it's pretty abstract what we're doing. So maybe just a few general statements. Almost everything humans do depend kind of their physical environment. So we all depend on what's happening around us. I mean, it starts with the weather, but for a farmer it depends what happens on the field, how vital are my plants, what's the topography to build a new mobile telephony network. So almost everything humans do kind of depend on the surrounding, and everybody knows today there are satellites, there are aircraft, and actually this is a very, very efficient way, or it's the only way actually to physically kind of get the information and about the surrounding and deriving information from that for day-to-day life. So there has been an industry since 30 years. There have been a lot of satellites launched. Billions of euros have been invested. But if you look at the current industry, it's still like a project-driven, governmentally owned market space. So actually, the industry failed to really bring these services to day-to-day life. And that's where Claudio comes into play. In a way, what's happening today, as the industry is structured, there are huge entry barriers for people who want to use that and want to come up with good services for individuals or for any type of vertical industry. And they have huge difficulties to find the data, to pay for the data, which are expensive, to build up the infrastructure, to know actually all the pieces. It's like the pre-industrialized society still, where if you want to do something, you have to go from the raw material to the end product. And that's a very complicated task. And that's what Claudio does. So we have kind of established a new ecosystem where we bring the share economy idea to that industry. So we make it very easy. We bring the infrastructure where people can now use it for rent or in revenue sharings, where they find easy access to the data. They find all they need to come up with good services for their end customers. And like that, stimulating thousands of applications which should be there. I mean, that's our thesis, because as I said in the beginning, almost everything depends on it. So that's Claudio.
So I think, you know, a good way to describe it is, you know, if you're a taxi company, you own cars, right? But if you're Uber, you say, there are enough cars on the road already, why don't I use those? And so what you're saying is, you know, yeah, I could launch satellites and, you know, find a use case for those. And, you know, there are many companies who do that, Planet Labs, you know, they're trying to launch lots of satellites and stuff like that. But what you are saying is, there's enough data already, or there's lots of people who are supplying data. Why don't we make this data more accessible? So that maybe even, you know, a farm cooperative could actually go to you and say, you know, we want a specific set of data, of information about our region, and we want to do something interesting with it. And it makes sense. You know, you don't actually have to go through all the hoops that you just described.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. So in the past, I went through building satellites. So we had my first startup was launching 5 satellites. So we found the company end of the 90s. We invested 150 million euros, so it was a lot of investment. But at the end, we really failed because the ecosystem was not right. And that's what we try this time to make different and concentrate on what is really required for bringing that to everyday life.
Yeah, and you're based right in the center of Munich, right? You know, a kilometer away from me.
So I can walk from my office here, and I can go by bike from my home to my office, and that's actually what I like.
Yeah, well, we'll get to that in a minute as well. So, Caroline, so you're driven very much by the thought of sustainability. I mean, sustainability plays a big role in German consciousness in general, I would say. But you looked at some of the issues that we face today, and you came up with a unique solution. So tell us a little bit about what you're doing with the Leaf Republic.
So Leaf Republic basically is a research and development company on the area of raw materials, of sustainable raw materials, and we concentrate on leaves, really on leaves from trees. First idea was we could make plates, one-way dishes, and food packaging out of leaves so that we don't have to cut trees anymore to pack our food. And we started our company in 2013, started to develop all of this, and now have a full running production facility here in Taufkirchen near Munich. So we're also producing in Germany. We're employing lots of refugees in our production, so we think the sustainability issue to the end, also a societal impact we do have. And this is only the beginning. So what we're also doing is we found a way to extract pulp, cellulose, out of these leaves, so that, again, we can really replace all sorts of paper or cardboard in the near future with pulp made from leaves.
And the really crucial thing is leaves just grow back, right? Whereas trees, you have to plant new trees, and then you have to wait 20 years until you can cut it down again. So you basically want to, just earlier we talked a little bit about how crazy it is what we're doing. I mean, literally there are trees that are grown in Russia that are cut down, ground up, and then transferred to the paper mills here in Germany, so to create cardboard boxes for your Amazon packaging, right? So how crazy is that? How sustainable can that ever be, right? And you want to replace that?
We want to think a step further. Of course, it makes sense to have renewable materials instead of oil-based materials. That's the first step. But then also we have to think about the ecosystems and what happens to them if we go on like this with all the resources we need. We have less paper because we buy less print magazines, of course, but we had lots more cardboard and packaging materials because we have so many singles, we have this urbanization, we have this get everything from Amazon instead of your local store. So the way we are living today is massively influencing the resources we do have. And there are some issues that you can't simply solve with digitalization. Yeah, your iPad won't replace toilet paper in the near future.
Hopefully not, yeah. So on the topic of sustainability, obviously Germany is very big in sustainable energy generation. A lot of people are looking towards Germany as a model, how to do things in the future. And of course, with this transformation of energy generation to renewables, there come a lot of challenges, right? And almost on a daily basis in German newspapers, you can read about it. So one of the big challenges is energy storage. How can we make sure that renewables, which are intermittent, can be stored for use when the sun is not shining and the wind is not blowing? And so, Jakob, you started a company together with two co-founders to do something about it. So obviously the solution is battery storage. But the batteries we are producing today, in Elon Musk's Gigafactory and other manufacturing sites are not really that well suited to the demands of renewable energy storage. So tell us a little bit about what Volt Storage does.
Yeah, that is very true. So there are certain types of energy storage, and they're suitable for certain types of application, obviously. And we build a battery for private households who have solar panels on the rooftop. So they're specifically designed for that. Most people don't realize that if you just have solar panels on the rooftop, you use only 15% of that energy. The rest you have to feed into the grid. So this causes a lot of other problems within the grid and on a global scale. So if you want to achieve a much higher percentage of renewables within the grid, we need to do something about it. We need to store the electricity for later use. So what we do, we build a storage device for private households, which can store the electricity at daytime, make the world a bit night, which makes it globally, not just for the private households, very sustainable. And how we differentiate from, for example, the Tesla Powerwall, is that our technology is not flammable. So your house won't burn down just because of the battery. And so it's very safe. And the charging cycles are unlimited, so you can charge and discharge the battery as often as you want without losing capacity or power output. So this is an effect you probably know from your smartphone, which gets weaker and weaker over time. We don't have that issue. And most important, our goal is to make it financially viable. So we aim at storage costs, which means the price to store 1 kilowatt hour of electricity will be 50% below those of the closest competitor. So it will become actually financially viable for the customer to buy such a storage device, install it, and self-consume the electricity they produce.
Yeah, so you know, you could imagine a world where you know, everyone produces their energy locally with their solar cells on their roof, and the grid is basically a backup system. You know, it's no longer the primary means of providing energy for you. So we mentioned Tesla, Powerwall and stuff, and a couple of years ago, my wife, who's over here, and I were invited to a small reception at the Tesla Service Center just outside Munich. And Elon Musk was there, and he answered a lot of questions about the future of Tesla, etc. And there were a lot of interesting questions, there were a lot of boring questions as well. But there was one particularly interesting question. So somebody in the audience said, Elon, what would you do if you wouldn't do Tesla and SpaceX and all the other stuff that you're doing in your free time? What segment would you go into? What fascinates you? What do you think is ripe for plucking? And he said, I would look into electric aircraft. And that was like a couple of years ago, so I was like, this sounds really far-fetched. I mean, aircraft are these big things, that consume a lot of energy and fly for a long time and are very sensitive to the weight of, the drive system and the fuel. So, crazy, right? Well, it turns out there are three electric aircraft startups, in the south of Bavaria. There's Electra, who are looking into stratospheric airplanes, to replace satellites, powered by solar energy. And we're going to hear, from Bertrand Piccard next, tomorrow, I think, about his circumnavigation of a solar-powered plane. We have Lilium Aviation, which just got a $10 million financing round from the founder of Skype, Niklas Zennström. And, Frank Anton, you held a lot of different positions at Siemens. You're a pilot. And people always told you electric aircraft, that's impossible to do. You can't do that. And when you hear the word impossible, you say, okay, let's try it. So Siemens did something very interesting. They said, Siemens has to reinvent itself. I mean, imagine, Siemens was founded on the invention of the telegraph and the electric motor. But now we are more than 100 years later, and Siemens actually has to make sure that they are going back into startup mode so they don't get sidelined by all the new developments in technology. And so they created something called Next 47. Which is kind of an incubator accelerator program where companies can start. And that's exactly what you did, with eAircraft, right?
That's right, Lynn. The Next 47 and eAircraft is a part of Next 47. We are, on the one hand, a small startup, so we can be very flexible and do things that you not necessarily can do in the normal environment of a large company. But at the same time, we are large, because we have this big company behind us, which can help us with all its means. So we have like these hundreds of lawyers, hundreds of IP lawyers, all these specialists who can help us if we need their help. But also we have big businesses who eventually, when we come up with something special with a new technology, might also have an interest in this technology, which again sort of draws the technology from us. What are we doing? Our claim is we develop hybrid electric propulsion systems for aircraft. And we started with small aircraft, like two-seaters, four-seaters, and you could see some of these aircraft fly during the past year, 2016. But the claim really is we go for the large aircraft, the regional aircraft with 60 passengers, 100 passengers traveling for distances of 1,000 kilometers. And yes, you are rightly saying I'm a pilot. According to my experience during my business life, I always saw it is important to understand the application. If you understand the application, you can do better business. I saw that in most of the time I spent in healthcare, where I saw that very clearly. And now, being a pilot, I not only understand the application, I love the application. That might even help a little bit more. But the important thing is to do this together with application partners. So we are doing it together with Airbus in Ottobrunn. We are doing it with some other small aircraft manufacturers like Diamond Aircraft, a very innovative one in Austria, like Pipistrel, a very innovative one in an extremely innovative area, by the way, in Slovenia, in the Ljubljana area. So as you see, we are working with small and we are working with large. And that's important also for us. We are small as e-aircraft within Next 47 of Siemens. We are working with small. We are large as Siemens. We are working with a large Airbus. And why is Munich such a fantastic place? Because Munich is good for local and Munich is good for global. Here in the Munich area, and if you extend it a little bit, if you draw a circle of, let's say, 150, 200 kilometers radius around Munich, you find all sorts of small, medium-sized and large innovative companies, technology, 3D printing, carbon fiber, and IT technology. You find all that. So this is the good local part. At the same time, we as a global company, Munich is good for global. You just jump in a plane here and have direct connections to the valley, to all the valleys in the world, and to our third hubs in Erlangen and in Budapest, which is also a very innovative place. We only have like 2 hours door to door. So Munich is good for local, Munich is good for global.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I mean, the Munich airport, you know, this sounds like a trivial thing, but the Munich airport is one of the best airports in the world. You know, I think it was voted like the fourth best airport in the world just recently. And who here, you know, flew into Munich, you know, by plane? Okay, so it just works, right? I mean, I hope you didn't have a bad experience, you know, with all the snow and stuff like that, but generally it just works. You know, when I fly almost anywhere else, you know, it's always a hassle. You know, you get stuck in customs and stuff like that. In Munich, I mean, I hardly ever have a problem. You know, it takes me 20 minutes to go to the gate. So, you know, this is like an advantage that, you know, sounds trivial, but, you know, when you fly a lot, and, you know, in our global business, we do fly a lot, this all of a sudden becomes important. So yeah, I mean, I want to spend the next, you know, 10 minutes or so talk a little bit about why you guys are actually in Munich, or, you know, you are in Erlangen, but, you know, you're working with Airbus, who are in Munich. So I mean, all of you could have gone to the valley, or, you know, you actually, you know, Jakob, you just spent 3 months in Shenzhen, you know, as part of the HAX accelerator. So maybe I start with you, Jakob. Why did you actually come back? I mean, why didn't you stay in Shenzhen? I mean, HAX is financed by the US and is located in, you know, the world of Asian hardware productivity, right? You know, you can't get stuff done faster anywhere in the world in terms of hardware than in Shenzhen. So why don't you just move there?
That is true. So we spent the last 3 to 4 months in Shenzhen building our prototype, which was an incredible time. It was great to get there to the prototype, to get it work, because the iteration phase is extremely fast. You just give them the model and they do it within 24 hours, basically. They deliver it at night even. And it was a lot cheaper, but you need to do so, you need an incredible infrastructure, which we luckily receive from our investor. And the Chinese are very good in getting from A to B, but you have to be very specific what you want from them. But we wouldn't want to produce them. Like, our components are sourced globally, so we had to establish sourcing there, and the supply chain in China made sure that it was going to work. So we're going to have a subsidy in China later on. We're going to keep that. But we wouldn't have that access to talents, to the network we have in Munich, and all the infrastructure we receive here. If we go, we're going to obviously produce, like, the final assembly is going to take place in Germany just for copycat reasons, and because the know-how is here, and Germany is our first market. Otherwise, if we work together with contract manufacturers, they give us also a lot of input. So we receive a lot of input from partners we work together. It's not that we have to provide them all the information to do something, but we actually receive information and input from our partners, how to do things better, how to improve, and how to accelerate our production. And cost-wise, if I compare Munich to Silicon Valley and look at it from a global perspective, then Munich is actually pretty cheap. You have the talents. So the source, or kind of the talents you can hire here, at least as qualified as those in the Silicon Valley. And you can get them to a fraction of the price in Silicon Valley. And you don't have to compete with Facebook or Apple or anything else. So Munich makes just absolute sense for us. And Germany is our first target market. And so the closeness to the market is also a very important issue. So there are many reasons, actually, to stay
unique. So I think this is also an interesting message to politicians, right? You know, if you look at, Energiewende, the word that we coined for, changing all of our energy production to sustainable energy. Why is Jakob basing his company here in Germany, and why is this his primary market for the time being? Because Germany is actually trailblazing for the rest of the world, in this space. And it's very, very important in terms of politics that we continue that, and that we continue to be the trailblazers here, because otherwise companies like Jakob's would say, okay, maybe there's more going on in China. Actually, there's a lot of stuff going on in renewables in China now, and maybe that's the next target market, right? So I think this is very important that we keep that in mind. Companies like Jakob's company are starting up here and are staying here because of this leading role that Germany plays in that space. So, who else wants to chime in? I mean, why are you why are you in Germany, right? Why are you in Munich? Why are you not? I mean, robotics, you could move to Israel, to Tel Aviv, lots of stuff going on there. The Valley, obviously, maybe Seattle, Amazon is very close there. What keeps you here?
I think that's the important question, because if you would ask me why I'm here, I would have to say because my partner moved to Munich and then okay. I didn't have
it's
a job.
Good reason,
have a job, so I started my company. That was the starting point. But of course, today I maybe strengthen the point of talent. We have an extremely international team. As I said before, we're the biggest team when it comes to advanced robotics. So robotics, which is driven by AI, a lot of computer vision, deep learning, robots which decide on themselves what to do when they're in a warehouse. And to do so, you need people. And software is the biggest part of our company, although we do hardware, so it's nice to have all the motor producing companies and everything what you need to build a robot within 100 kilometers around Munich. That's nice. But I think the main driver is that we get talent here, and not only from the very good universities, but also internationally. I would have never thought that it's so easy to hire people. And we hire people from South Korea, we hire people from China, we hire people from Tunisia, a lot of them from Europe. And immigration into Germany, when they get paid enough and they're in the software segment, is very, very simple, right? They come here, we sent them a contract before, they can start working, and I'm very happy that we have this open market. And we had several employees who couldn't get into the US, who could have gotten a job there just because of immigration reasons. Yeah. And we were open enough to welcome the people here. And when they're in Munich, they usually like it because it's a very international town, and you have the quality of life level is pretty high as well. And as you said before, compared to other countries, Munich, although it's the most expensive city in Germany, it's still cheaper than in a lot of places all over the world.
Yeah, I mean, there's a reason why Munich is so expensive, because the quality of living is extremely high here. I mean, just from my personal experience, I mean, my first 10 years of my of my company, we basically had the west coast of the United States as the main customers. So why didn't I move there? Because I didn't find it attractive. I mean, both my wife and I didn't find it attractive. My kids can bike to work, can bike to their schools. I can walk to work. Can take the bicycle to go shopping. Where in the world can you do that? And where on the west coast of the United States can you do that? I mean, how many hours can you get stuck in on Highway 101? When you're trying to get from A to B in the valley. Stuff is very simple here. And the quality of living is very high. So, even though, basically, for almost 50 years I did mainly business with the United States, I never, the thought of moving never crossed my mind. And even my new company, which is also global, of course, it's here in Munich. But I hire people from all over the world. And that is actually, so you actually must love Donald Trump, because if he makes it harder for people to immigrate to the United States, more people will come to Munich and we can hire them all here.
Maybe that's the only reason why you could love him.
Yeah, I mean, it's probably, Anyway, yeah, so who wants to chime in? What keeps you in Munich?
Manfred. It's a complex issue. I mean, it's as easy as I studied here. I have my social network. I love the city. It's you as you said, you do everything by bike. You have beautiful places. That's one part. But of course, making a business or doing business, that should not be the major reason why to stay somewhere. But if you look what we always did, this was pretty holistic. So it was from a application of complex technology space, but into all different types of industries. It was from insurance to agriculture to everything. And that's, I think, is what for us is important, is to have access to a pretty diverse industry and multi-industry, so not just very narrow into some specific aspect. So really pretty broad, and I think that's what Munich gives ideally. I mean, you all big corporates, all different types of applications, whatever, are kind of close here. So you have a close contact to your customers, and of course, talent has been said before, and that's true. I mean, you have so many good people, and so many people who would like to come to Munich from the outside. I mean, our company, we have about 70% of non-Germans in our company. I mean, our language is English, actually, which sounds strange as a startup being in Munich, but our documents are all English because half of my people don't speak German, so it is a pretty international place, and it's easy. It's some kind. I mean, it's everybody's complaining about bureaucracy in Germany, but at the end, it's not really true. At least that's our experience.
Yeah, I mean, Frederick said something to me over dinner the other day. He said, if the bureaucracy, I mean, there is a certain level of bureaucracy in Germany, but if that's the reason why your company fails. Well, I don't know about your company, right? It's probably, it was doomed to fail to begin with. Yeah, Caroline, I mean, you're producing your stuff just outside Munich.
Yes.
I mean, that sounds like totally crazy. I mean, who actually builds stuff in Germany? Isn't it supposed to be some, thing in Thailand or, Vietnam or whatever? Why are you doing it here in Germany?
I think actually there's no better place in the world to produce innovative stuff than Germany, and especially Munich, honestly. Of course, we started our business here because myself, I've got two little kids, my co-founder has one daughter, so it was pretty clear that we would stay here out of family reasons. But you see, we have all sort of technical infrastructure in and around Munich. We have this small and middle machine building companies, very specialized, very talented, that helped us with our special machines because nobody ever pressed leaves into plates before. Yeah, we had to start it all from the scratch. And actually, I'm classical finance girl and business administration studies, and my co-founder comes from the movies and from sales. So we don't have any technical or biological background, and we found everything here. We have these universities, these different universities in Munich, with students that are working for our company, which makes it easy for new hires here. And we have a lot of tech companies. We have the Makerspace from BMW and the TUM that allows us for drilling our tools ourselves there at extremely cheap costs, so we can do rapid prototyping there. And I think it's a big mistake if you only take the costs into consideration that you see on paper. We're working very closely with India because we source our leaves from there. That's the only ones that work so well for our plates, actually. But we could not start our business there because there's a different mentality, there's a different type of working, there's a different idea of quality there. And this is what you can get in Munich. You can get extremely high quality. You have people that think by themselves, that improve your processes and your product. And if we, at one day, we are at a point where we say we have a fully automated production that is really this Pokajoke, yeah, that you cannot make anything wrong as a human being, then we could start outsourcing it. Because we saw so many companies moving to Asia and moving back 10 years later, yeah, with extreme losses because they all underestimated the transaction costs. It's not about people in India working 6 hours, six days a week and 10 hours a day, but it's about the productivity, and it's about the quality, and it's about the time lag from shipping the products there to their arrival in Munich. And the quality check again. You cannot do a high-tech product with rapid development cycles on another continent. It just doesn't make sense.
Yeah. Oh, it makes perfect sense to me. Yeah, we're out of time and we're standing between you and lunch. I just want to say, you know, I think we're all facing global problems, global challenges today. So we all have to think globally. We all have to start global companies. I mean, it's by default, it's global. But I think it's very important that we keep in mind, you know, that the local fabric of our region is actually a very, very important support network for us entrepreneurs. And so, you know, wherever you are in the world, I mean, I think it's important to pay attention to the local fabric and to the local community. And if you can make a contribution to building that up, you know, I'm very active in mentoring young entrepreneurs and stuff like that. It's a tiny contribution, but it helps. I think it's a really, really important step towards solving all these challenges. And if everyone does that in their local community, and if all the local communities come together, well, we can actually change the world. So thank you very much for listening, and thank you, you know, to all the panelists for, you know, all these insights. And yeah, go get your lunch.